We're going to turn, we're in a series right now called Body Armor. We're focusing on Ephesians for several weeks this summer. And I get section 2, so we're going to turn to Ephesians 2, and I'm going to read 1 through 10. And the first version I'm going to read out of is the NLT. I don't ever recommend having just one, when you're studying scripture, I don't recommend having just one translation, just because it's so, the word is so rich, and each of us has a different worldview and things that we come in with. And so when you're able to compare it to different translations, I feel like God's able to give you a broader scope of what he's actually trying to say and how to apply it to your life now, since this wasn't actually written to 2023 Reno onions, people who live in Reno in 2023. It was actually written quite a bit ago. And so we want to be open to what he meant to the when it was being written, and we want to be open to who it was directed to, but also knowing that this, the word is, scripture is alive. It is, scripture says that it's like a double-edged sword that separates joint and marrow. I never want to know what that feels like, but I think it means it's really precise. It gets really in there. So we're going to read through, I'm going to read through all the verses 1 through 10. So if you guys follow along, I've got it on the screen. And then if you have your Bible app or you have your Bible, it says, and again, this is Paul writing a letter to the Ephesians. He says, "Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins, you used to live in sin, just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is a spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we are subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. But God is so rich in mercy. He loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved, for he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Jesus Christ. So God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness toward us, as shown in all he has done for those who are united with Christ. God saved you by his grace when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Verse 9, salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done. So none of us can boast about it, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus, so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago." Let's pray before we get into talking about this. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the space that we get to occupy right now. Lord, I thank you for your word that you have left with us to live by, to learn and grow by. But I pray for just a different level of understanding and learning today as we press into your word. Holy Spirit, thank you for being here. Thank you for that worship. Lord, for meeting us in that space and for speaking to so many of us today before we leave here, so that when we head out into the world, we are changed. We don't just come here to take up a space, but we occupy a space in an anointed and holy way so that we're changed. And so just like your word is telling us here, that we actually get to be an example of your mercy and grace because of how we've grown today, what we take with us into this week. Just be glorified in our time today, Lord. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, so here's the skinnies. I've got two skinnies of this passage, and they're kind of big ones. It starts off and it says, "We were all sinners, all of us." And this is kind of a side tangent, but I love giving homework. So I really encourage you to go through and read all the times in scripture where it talks about that we were past tense sinners. That's not what my message is today, but it kept coming up as I was reading through this, and it's something that was intriguing to me, and I felt like God kept bringing it around. So that's my challenge to you. It's past tense. We were all sinners. And then it says, "We used to obey the devil," like obey the devil, just like really dramatic, right? But that's who we were. That was what we were called before we knew Jesus. And then now we are all forgiven, all of us. Not some of us. You're forgiven whether you want it or not, actually. It's just whether you're accepting it and walking in it that changes who you are and how you live for God. But weirdly, we very often don't act like we were sinners. We act like we are sinners. But in verse 4, it says, but God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were, past tense, dead in our sins, he gave us life when he raised us, when he raised Jesus Christ from the dead. So we've been raised with Christ. And it's weird that we don't always act like it. You know, maybe we have good days and bad days, but it's really strange when I look around, and even in my own past, that we just are so focused on the sin, we're focused on our own things, and we're very, like Craig was saying, actually, that word that he spoke, I think, is so important, that if we are able to pay attention to the things that are true about who God says we are, it is going to change every person around us. The ripple effect that we get to have is actually really fantastic. And then it's exciting to be a Christian. It doesn't change that it's hard. It doesn't change that we have hard things. But we're no longer so focused on who we were and always, you know, or often trying to get back to that, that we're actually able to focus on the here and the right now, which is he gave us life when Christ raised us, when Christ was raised from the dead. That's where I want to stand. That's where I want to plant my feet, in that promise. And every time something comes up that tries to make me doubt or call myself a sinner, I want to just say this verse over and over and over again. And this life that we're leading, the other thing that this section talks about is this life that we're leading has nothing to do with us. That's why it's so important for us to know that stuff I just talked about. And I think even Leilani said that, and she didn't know that that's what I was preaching on today. But that, it's so important. And I think it's been echoed several times already this morning, even in our songs. So God's trying to say something to someone here. I'm thinking it's several of us since these chairs are full. The areas in which we're gifted, the blessings we receive, the hard things that we experience, our bottom line, so that we can stop whatever it takes. God uses all these things to get us to stop obeying the devil and use every bit of our life for loving God and loving his people. In verse 7, it says we can do the good things that he planned for us long ago. Last week, Craig talked about when that was, and it was before the world was even created. Man, I love planning. I'm such a planner. My planner has stickers in it. It's like highlighted. It's so pretty. Very organized. I hardly look at it, to be honest with you, but it's for sure organized. And so, God is even more, he's more intense of a planner than I am, which is just wild to me because he's been thinking about this for thousands of years into eternity the other direction. You know, we always think about eternity this way, but there's like this whole other side. It's actually backwards for you guys, right? I mean, he's been thinking about this forever. Forever goes every direction. He's always existed. God has always existed, and I'll never be able to wrap my mind around that. Okay, so now I'm going to switch over to the Message version of this Bible verse, and it's so salty. When I was reading through it, I love the NLT, I love the ESV. I highly recommend having one of those as your main go-to for your Bible translation, but then pair it against other things, like I was saying. But this one, when I was reading through it, I was like, oh, dang! So get ready. It's real good. And I've got it up on the screen for you guys. It says, it wasn't so long ago that you were mired in that old, stagnant life of sin. You let the world, which doesn't know the first thing about living, tell you how to live. So salty. I was like, oh, this is so rude right to my face. And I wasn't applying this to you guys whatsoever. I was literally applying this to me when I read through it. You filled your lungs with polluted unbelief and then exhaled disobedience. Oh my gosh. We all did it. All of us doing what we felt like doing when we felt like doing it. All of us in the same boat. If I was writing this, I would have wrote stupid. The same stupid boat, right? It's a wonder God didn't lose his temper and do away with a whole lot of us. Instead, and this is where his mercy shows up. This is who God is. All the first stuff was the truth about us. And as humans, probably how we would handle it. But this is who God is. And this is where we get to camp. These are the promises that we get to tuck away inside of ourselves so that every time we're tempted to doubt that God is who he says he is or we can do what he says we can, we get to come back to this. It says, instead, immense in mercy and with an incredible love, he embraced us. He's doing that now. In all the hard stuff, he's embracing us. There's times we don't allow it. We don't receive it. But that doesn't change who God is. So what this passage is asking is that we change our perspective. We change how we are stepping into the truth of who God says we are so we can receive his embrace. If you're stuck, it's you. Sorry. I'm not sorry. It's the same for me. When I am stuck, it's because I'm refusing what God is offering. So if you're stuck, if you keep finding yourself running around the same stupid mountain, then there's a really good chance that it's something that you are putting in the way. Scripture says the road to God is narrow. That means that we're really easily able to block it with our own stuff. It's just one thing. There's just one guy. It's just Jesus that gets us there. And if we refuse to allow him in and do the things that he's, all these things that he's wanting to do, just embrace us, I mean, all he wants to do is give us a hug and then just kind of let it go from, you know, head to toe and see how that changes us. He took our sin-dead lives and made us alive in Christ. He did all this on his own with no help from us. And then he picked us up and set us down in the highest heaven in company with Jesus, our Messiah. He sat us down. I love that. I love that so much. In the NLT, that verse says, God seated us with Christ in the heavenly realms. He seated us. We did not climb some ladder. We did not walk to something. We did not arrive in a place when we were still junky and janky and messed up and dead in our sins. He seated us. Have you guys ever walked into or been in an experience where, I don't know, either in church or maybe on a, I don't know, public transportation or at a restaurant or in a place where maybe there's somebody there that you know that if you sit down next to them, they're not going to smell real great, or it's not going to be a good experience, or they're going to have bad manners, and you just want to eat your food? Oh gosh, I wasn't going to tell the story, but I'm going to give you guys this exact example. I went into a burger joint that had seriously like one of the best burgers. I'll talk to you about it later. But I sat down, and I had ordered a burger and fries, and the kid was brand new, and he was maybe 16 years old. Awesome. Awesome customer service. And this really funny girl who was his supervisor, I think, was like 4 minutes older than him, and she was like power crazy with it, right? And if you've seen these kiddos, I was probably these kiddos. I'm very bossy. And so he said, I gave him my, I had to pay with a 50 because they're, I had stolen a 50 from my husband's wallet. And so their little credit card, their computer was down, so I had to pay with cash. And I was like, dang it, I wasn't going to spend my 50 stolen dollars on a burger, but here it is. I was going to buy myself something nice. So he was so confused at what to do with the 50 because there's a spot in the register for the 100, the 20, you know what I'm saying, for everything. And he like holds it up and announces, where do I put this thing? He was so overwhelmed. And the girl comes over and she was like, first of all, and I was like, oh, dang. And so I got front seat for that teenager interaction. And so I wanted to encourage him, but I wanted her to finish, you know, and she's working there. She gets paid to supervise him. It's fine. So I wanted to encourage him. She shows him what to do. And she's like, you have to take the pen and make sure it's real. And she's talking just like that. And I was like, this is where I would have walked actually someplace else. But good for you, buddy, for submitting to that authority. And he was like, yeah, I did that. And he had done all the things that she had said. He literally had just asked, which, you know, and it's kind of a valid question if you've never used a register before. And so she's like, well, did you put it in the middle? And he goes like this, who said anything about putting it in the middle? I was like, I love this kid. He's kind of salty. So anyway, so I watched that interaction. And then I'm thinking, he's actually doing a really great job, and she just keeps giving him such a hard time. There's no praise from her. And then right as I'm about to praise this kid and just try to encourage him, since I'm in the room and I want to occupy the space God's given me, he goes over to the window, grabs a burger, and I'm at the bar that's like this wide, and he stands in front of me. Okay, first of all, the whole bar is empty, okay? But apparently he and I are here together. And he stands in front of me while he's working and making other stuff for people, and he just starts horking on that burger. And I was like, what is happening right now? I'm all, sir, we are not together. What is happening? And so then I'm him, and I'm like looking around at all the empty chairs, and I'm like, what are we doing? And, you know, to be fair, he had pretty decent manners, but I do not know that guy. I do not want to sit here with this kid. And you know what? I'm not going to actually encourage you in the job you're doing. Well done. Because not only are you sitting here right now, I did encourage him later. I waited, though. But he not only is he eating a burger in front of me, but he stops what he's doing and goes to make prepare someone else's food without washing his hands. And I was all, ah, because I'm a mom. My finger is like right here. I'm all, you need to wash your hands before you make that man's milkshake. And he goes, oh my gosh, thank you so much for telling me. I was like, oh, customer service has just gone down the hill. I mean, it was nuts. But that was a situation I was in where I very passionately wanted to get out of that situation. I didn't want to sit with this kid. He kept going, this burger is so juicy. He would not stop yelling that. And I was like, I was reading a book, and I was like in my own space. And I'm all, this is not what those middle introvert extroverts want. You know, this is not what we want when we sit alone in a restaurant. So he was really sweet, and seriously, he wasn't lying about the burger, but still it was a situation where I did not want to be seated, and you know, for ridiculous reasons. But man, there's a lot of times where we say we don't want to be seated. We don't accept God seating us next to Jesus Christ, our Savior, because we feel like we're not worthy, or we don't want to enter into that situation. We don't want to be part of it. And so it's actually, once again, it is not God disqualifying us. It is not Jesus Christ disqualifying us. They've already said we were a mess, but they love us. Instead, it's actually some of y'all just need to sit down. You just need to sit in that space and occupy that space and say, I am actually loved. I am actually new because of what Christ did on the cross for me. I think we could all agree without me taking a survey that this world's getting pretty wacky. I don't know how else to say it. It's stressful. And we might be tempted to freak out when we look around, or, you know, we're so inundated with news and, you know, doomsday, everything. I mean, it is just bad news is everywhere. It is just not hard to come by, which is why mostly I follow those Instagram accounts where kids get hurt. It's so much better, you guys. And they always say in the bottom, it's like, the kid was fine. Like, it clarifies, you know what I mean? Like, don't worry, this was approved. But it's, you know, it's so crazy. Like, every time I'm talking to my husband, and we're trying not to freak out. You know, we're still raising kids. We've got one son left at home. We've got grandkids now. We've got, you know, our kids are off getting married now. So our family has grown in a way, and we're new to this season. We're trying to do it well. And it's still really tempting to look around and be really scared at the stuff that's going on around us. And it's really easy to forget how unbelievably mighty God is, and that he's got all of this when everything else is so loud. And if for us, because we're not in Roman times, it feels so extra insane. But to God, it's like, this is all stuff I have seen before. And still, I've got this. I had the whole plan before any of this came about. Still, I've got this. So, like, I'm talking to my husband about the news or my former job or what the school district is doing or the powdered sugar that can't seem to be identified at the White House. And he's like... He does the same thing like every time, and he just starts doing this. I'm like, babe, have you heard about, and he's all, and I'm like, what do you mean, no? I'm like, have you heard about what's going on at the White House? And he's like, I'm all, that guy, and they can't find that. I'm like, stop shaking your head. What are you doing? Stop shaking your head. No. And then at the end of it, whatever it is, whatever the crazy thing is, he goes like this, and he's like, what is happening? He does it every time, and I've got a picture. He does it so often, I was able to catch it in a photo, you guys. It's every time. And I'm just like, bro, this is real. You cannot opt out. But our focus can change. Our focus, I'm not even kidding that is, he's not here today, but that's on him. He just keeps shaking his head. I just keep talking. I'm like, whatever, I have stuff to say to you. But I you know, there's such a big part of me that wonders if God looks down and he looks just like Mike Brewer. And he's just like, but you know what's amazing? He doesn't. That's what this passage is telling us. The scripture is saying that he doesn't actually look at us like that. He's so immense that he's actually coming in for a hug. He's not sitting there shaking his head at us thinking we're insane or I made a mistake or I can't believe this is how things are going down. Because yes, he can, because you know what? He was here. I mean, we don't have time to get into the historical timeline and the biblical timeline of the crazy that Jesus probably saw, but you can go back and just listen to even a little snippet of Craig's teaching last week. He talked about some of the stuff that was happening up the steps of the churches there. It was not okay. You know, we have a lot of stuff that's happening in secret. Those guys were just out there in the open with it. I mean, and so I can't imagine how much more overwhelming that was. You know, and we are so sheltered here in the United States about things that are going on, like actual, real, major problems. And I think what happens is we easily get sidetracked into thinking those are a big deal. And I'm not saying that what we deal with is not a big deal. You know, I know that these guys with their Real Choices ministry, everything, every day is a big deal in that ministry, you guys. It is changing lives. It is changing. It's actually continuing generations that the devil's trying to kill off. We're supposed to be generational. I don't even know how many times that word is in scripture, but it's a lot. God did stuff way back here for generations here. You know, those promises are for us. What he was talking about there, that's for us. So don't feel like that if there's a really big bug. Sorry, man. There, don't feel like this stuff doesn't apply to you. We are the generations that scripture was talking about. And it's time for us to stop acting like we're not that generation. We're not those people. Those are not our promises. But the great thing is that every time that God does look at us, even when we are calling ourselves something that we're not, even when we're speaking lies over to ourselves, even when we are people who beg for blessing and then take all the credit, he doesn't do this. He doesn't shake his head and do this. When we are people who speak nonsense over our lives, when we go against his word and have sex outside of marriage, you guys, that has been talked about like that is no big deal. That has been acted upon like that is no big deal. But God made that, and he made that for inside of marriage. And I am so tired of people acting like I'm the prude. Because you know what? That is one of the easiest things for the devil to get a hold of, because sex is nice, okay? I've been married for almost 30 years. And when we are too scared to talk about stuff like that as a church or proclaim that, or when we are in the church and we do things like we look at this lady and think, gosh, she's so nice, I think I'll just move on in with her. And we don't talk about, you know, we just set aside the marriage part and the covenant part. Go home and read about covenant. Go home and read about how one man's covenant, it's so many times in scripture, but one man's covenant with God changed generations. Our lives are changed because of the covenant Joshua had with God. Our lives are changed because of the covenant he had with Moses, with Abraham. Our lives are different because of that one covenant with that one man, Joshua, who wholeheartedly followed God. That's how God describes him. He wholeheartedly. You cannot wholeheartedly follow God and expect all of these blessings and all of these things and expect that you're going to be able to turn around and take God's embrace in the whole way that he means it if you're actually sleeping with somebody on the side. It does not work. I've never been clapped. There's never been clapping when I preached before. That was fun, Craig. I like that. I'm not a yeller. I'm always talking about, why do all the preachers like yelling at me? I'll do what you want. Just tell me what it is. I'm not a yeller, but there are some things, you guys, that just make me feisty, and I'm just tired of watching the fallout. I'm tired of it. There's a guy in Matthew 19, and they don't even name him, I don't think. He just comes in, and he's like, Rabbi, what do I need to do to be saved? And Jesus is like, here, I'll tell you exactly. Just sell your stuff. And the guy's like, just like take your time in thinking about the answer. And Jesus is like, sell your stuff. This is a paraphrase. So Jesus is like, sell your stuff. And he's like, just, you know, go ahead and take your time. Like, it doesn't seem like you've thought it through. And Jesus is like, sell your stuff. And he's like, okay, so you're like, when you're ready, like, I'm going to be right here whenever you've got that answer, whatever it is I need to do. And Jesus is like, sell your stuff. And it says the man went away sad. And I think, you know what? He wasn't sad because what God was saying. He was sad because he knew he was choosing not to opt in. And we have to choose to opt in. We have to choose that. We're like over there going like, door number two. Do you have a door number two? And Jesus is like, no, I am the way. And, you know, is there any other thing that you could possibly think of to ask me other than this thing? Because it is just too hard. Or it is, you know, we say things like, we don't confess this because it's too scary, but we say things like, don't you know how embarrassing this is for me to have to go and admit that I've sinned in this way? We've been living together for 20-something years. Now you want me to admit that this wasn't okay and get married? Yeah, that's actually exactly what he's asking. What he's saying is, look at that woman, look at that man, and honor covenants as I have set them forth in Scripture. Do something different so that you get different results. I mean, that's a worldly tactic, but God is saying, all I'm asking is for you to actually, whatever, admit, accept, forgive, surrender, trust. But he knows because he was here. And we need to realize that we are not the star of this show. And the longer that we keep focusing on things like what feels right to me or what feels good to me, or, you know, that's a little bit too uncomfortable, and we keep walking away sad like this guy in Matthew, we genuinely should not expect much on the other end. I mean, God is still God, so he still does what he wants. But we shouldn't, it shouldn't be expected. Like right now, if I am, I screw up all the time, you guys, so I'm not saying I'm perfect, but if I'm doing my best and I'm putting my best foot forward and I'm seeking God and I'm apologizing when I need to apologize and when I'm submitting when I need to submit and I'm doing everything I can to actually follow what God is asking of me, if I'm occupying my spaces, if I'm speaking my worth over myself, then I walk into that throne room and I'm expecting change. I'm expecting God to deliver, and it's my right to. That's what Scripture says. It's my right to. I get to. He can't do. How are we on time? All right. I'm just going to share this thing that Jacob said to me the other day because it has stuck with me. If you guys haven't met Jacob, he's good times. So he's got an amazing, amazing testimony, which I am not going to share. But at the start of his testimony, he said something that it just keeps replaying in my mind. And he said he sat down. And he said, however long this takes, he was in a really uncomfortable space. And he sat down and he's like, I don't care, whatever this takes, I'm going to do anything, whatever this takes, so that he could find the recovery that he needed. And I think that God looked at Jacob, I mean, and he was messy, okay? This was no small thing that he was trying to overcome. God was trying to do a complete revolution in his life, a complete turnaround, a 180. And Jacob said, I'm in, whatever it takes, however painful this is, whatever it takes. And I think that God looked down and said, Jacob, I can work with that. You know what I'm saying? Like, he didn't ask for anything else from him. He's not asking for anything else from us. Just that we're standing, that we're rooted, we're in this space, and we're saying, I got this. And I get so excited. I'm going to read the rest of this passage out of the Message, but I get so excited when I see things like that, when I hear testimonies like that. And God does too. He wants those to be our testimonies, but we have got to stop acting like we are the star of this show. It's not about us. You walked in this room. Of course, I hope you get something from today, but you walked in this room to fill up, to pay it forward to somebody later this week. And if you're not looking for that person, you've really missed a moment. Okay, so now it says, in verse 7 through 10, now God has us where he wants us, with all the time in this world and the next to shower grace and kindness upon us in Jesus Christ. Saving is all God's gift, start to finish. We don't play the major role. If we did, we'd probably go around bragging that we'd done the whole thing. No, we neither make nor save ourselves. Say that. We neither make nor save ourselves. We had nothing to do with that. Nothing. All the next steps are up to us, though. He creates each of us by Christ Jesus to join him in the work he does, the good work he has gotten ready for us to do, work we had better be doing. I love that line. Work we had better be doing sounds like my mom yelling for me from the other room saying you had better be doing your chores. She's only 4'9", but she is so Italian. Everyone is scared of her, even if she's not your Italian mom. You had better, it's work you had better be doing. Like I hear it in her voice. That's what Paul's reminding us here, that it's work that we had better be doing. And I just want to, read that like 1,000 times. Because the sooner that we realize that whatever we're facing, the work, you know, whatever that thing is, a relationship, a job you want, a job you don't want anymore, a phantom chains that have you believing that you are tied to sexual sin, to addiction, or worse, apathy. That's the devil's greatest lie to us right now, genuinely, church. I think that apathy is the thing that has taken over because we keep thinking things like, well, I'm not doing anything overtly bad. But are you doing anything overtly good? Are you speaking up for people that can't speak for themselves? Are you all in and investing in those babies God gave you? That's such a big deal. Those kids are going to be running our country, and I would thank you to pay attention to them. That would be really awesome. Have you guys heard of this buffalo mentality? I know they're supposed to be called bison, but I didn't name the mentality. So it's this buffalo mentality. And it's this idea that when there's a storm, so I imagine Oklahoma, right? So there's like no mountains to break up any kind of weather. And these, tornadoes or twisters or whatever come in. And these cows see these storms coming and they take off running. And what happens is that not only so the cows don't have the proper instincts. And so they don't know to run away from the storm. They just know to run. They just know something's happening, and so they run. And it could be in the different direction, but very often, all that happens is they stay with the storm longer because they're just being willy-nilly and crazy cows, right? And so they end up dying, or they end up injured, and then dying from the injuries once the storm has passed. But buffalo, actually, they turn, and they literally face the storm, and they plant their feet, and they lean forward, it says. And what happens is the storm could be coming right at them. It could come sideways, backwards. It doesn't matter. But it actually passes them because they're choosing to be rooted in the thing that matters. They're choosing to occupy their space. That's a real thing. I had no idea. It was so amazing. And so that's what I want for us. That's what I want for my life. I want my life to mean something. And I genuinely think every one of you do too. Otherwise, what are we doing? I mean, why are you here? Not just in this room, but in every single space that where God brings you. What are we doing? If we're so insistent on hanging on to the one thing that God's asking us to set down, that we're just so in the way, that we cannot accept his love fully, because that one thing we keep hanging on to keeps reminding us that we're not worth it. But that's not true. So the sooner we set it down and the sooner we move past it, we actually get to step into God's full embrace. I don't know about you, but I would straight knock all of you down if Jesus was standing right back there, right? I'm getting a hug first. I win at everything. I don't, but I really like to win at everything. But you know what I'm saying? Like if Jesus walked in right now and we knew that he was Jesus, I would be hightailing it. I would be like, nope, women and children, I don't care nothing about none of y'all. I am getting in my hug. That's what I want. Verse 7 back in the NLT said, God can point us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness toward us, as shown in all he has done for us who are united with Christ. If you have not said yes to Jesus, this is your day. If you are not united in Christ, this whole thing's going to be confusing, and you're going to be torn, and you're going to be blown. You're going to be just like those cows, and you're going to be like, okay, I know I'm doing something. I just don't know if it's the right thing. So get rooted in Jesus. Just say yes to him. You know, if you decide after living with him for a year or something that nothing changed, fine, set it aside, give it a try. You know, but that's not how God is. You say yes, and then he delivers. You say yes, and then he shows you up. You say yes, and all those things get smaller. They get easier to set down. And then all of a sudden, your life, all the stuff you've been through, gets to be a testimony for the guy next to you who is in that space you were a year ago and is saying, man, I never thought I could. I never thought I would. But I watched you and I saw you be scared, but I saw you do it anyway. And I think I can do it too. That's the kind of life I think that God is looking for us. Like it makes me so lit up. I feel like Wonder Woman in that scene where she like runs out and like all the mortals
are like don't understand her powers, and she just has those little wristbands and that tiny little outfit, and she like runs out there and she's like everything, like she's able to block all them bullets. And I think, wow, World War II is just so different because of you. But I think that's fake. You know what I mean? Like, we don't actually need that. We have even better than that because of what God has given us. The power. I have the power of Jesus Christ in me. You have the power of Jesus Christ in you, but you have to choose it. It's not gone anywhere. You have to choose it. You get to pray and make choices. You get to stand when it's time to stand, when you're supposed to. And only God is going to be able to tell you when you should stand and when you should sit down and when you should keep quiet. And if you don't know God's voice, if you're not in the Word and you don't know God's voice, even if you are a Christian, my personal advice is that you take a knee and stop talking. Because if you're out there pretending to be a voice for God and you don't even know what He sounds like, you are off track. And then when preachers come along, when false prophets come along, you're just going to believe what they say because you don't know the Father. And then you're passing it along to people as if God had spoken to you. God is not going to be proud of that. He's going to have this, I don't know, this Mike Brewer face. But when you do things for God, you get to stand confidently. But as Christians, when we're walking out there and we're saying things like, you know, it's okay for guys to dress up in drag and go read a story to a little kid because that's us dress up. It's okay for women to marry each other. Air quotes. It's okay for men to marry each other. It's okay for a homosexual family to adopt kids because those kids need a home. When we're saying things like that as Christian, you know, we can't define love. Yeah, we can, actually. It's all right here. I can even tell you how many page numbers it's written on in this version. Yeah, we can. When we're Christians and we're standing and we're saying, I'm not talking about how much God loves those people. That does not change. But when we're standing up there and we're talking about a different gospel than what God is talking about in those real covenants that He has with His kids, you're making God a liar. That's what happens. And that's not okay. God is not going to reward the fruit of the life that you are living. So what we need to be doing is we need to be standing on these principles. The only thing that we need to know is what's inside of here. God takes care of so much of the rest of it. And personally, I would really like to stop pushing the line until He does what He did in the Old Testament and just turns everybody over to their sin. And then it gets real crazy because that's what He does. Right now, we're functioning like cows. And what I want is I want us to get rooted in the gospel. I want to get rooted in scripture. I want to get rooted in community, in church, so that every time we're standing someplace, we're occupying the space that God has given us, and we're able to discern and see through the lies, and we're able to declare truth and help other people, bring them along with us, get out of those chains. Some of you have a thing maybe that while I've been talking, you have a thing that you've been thinking of, this thing that you're holding on to too tightly, or this thing that maybe these chains that you have spoken over yourself or that are in a space, they're keeping you in a space where you're not able to accept God's embrace. And what I'm going to ask is for the prayer team to come up here. And if that's you, if you have identified something, if the Holy Spirit has been talking to you while I've been talking to you and saying, that's a thing, you need to let this go. You need to open your hands and let me handle this. I just encourage you to come up here for prayer. These guys are serious prayer warriors. I'm not even joking. They make a difference. You will leave here differently. Don't leave here the same. Don't keep clinging to that thing, hanging on to that thing, whatever it is. Just, even if you, in general, you feel like you've been living like a cow and you want to be a buffalo, even if that's the prayer you want over your life, come up here and get prayer for that.